the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Aren't you glad that you serve the one true living God?
I've been here for 20 some years, and there was a time in this building when people were afraid to shout and show their love and devotion for Jesus. And we prayed and prayed and prayed about the Spirit being set free and being allowed to open up and just flow freely through this place. And today, I am witnessing the move of the Spirit flowing freely through this place. And I praise the Lord for that.
Salvation. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I sing to you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the Lamb of God. Praise the Lamb of God. You know, I feel the spirit of restoration here this morning. Praise God. Hallelujah. I felt that when I woke up today. You know, it is a brand new day. And you say that His mercies and compassions remain new for us ever.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Did you bring your Bibles tonight? Amen. Amen. You brought your Bible? Let's lift Him up and let's make this confession together. This is the Word of God.
This is the Word of God.
The incorruptible seed.
The incorruptible seed.
I am what it says I am.
I am what it says I am.
I can do what it says I can do.
I can do what it says I can do.
And praise God, I'll never be the same. Father God, we thank You tonight, Lord, for Your Word. We thank You, Lord, that You truly have changed the direction of our lives, Father God. We thank You, Lord God, that now our feet are planted on a firm foundation, Father God. Lord, Your Word is clearly, Lord, shown the way to us, Lord God. And we thank You, Lord, that You are the way, the truth, and the life. We thank You, Father God, Lord, for loving us the way that You do. We thank You, Lord God, for just pouring out Your love into our hearts. We thank You, Father God, for sending Your Word and healing us from our destruction, Father. Lord, thank You, Lord God, for allowing us to be gathered together in this place. In Your name, we give You the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen,
amen. Amen. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. We're going to turn to the book of James tonight, the first chapter. Do you love the book of James? I love it all, but the book of James is, it just gets right up in your face. How many knows we need that? Amen. So the book of James, first chapter, verse 14 says, but each one is tempted when by their old evil desire, hear what this is saying, by that old evil desire, they are dragged away and enticed. Just sharing with Brother Scooter Bob before the service, you know, that the old stinking devil, the only way that he can get to us is through this flesh. And that's why Paul says to crucify this thing. And you'll cut off any avenue for him to get to you. I'm just saying. Says, then after desire has been conceived or brought forth, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it becomes full grown, when it is finished, brings forth death. So this evening, I want to answer the question, what is sin? What is sin? We read about it, we hear about it, we suffer from it. So what are we dealing with? Well, the word sin itself originated many, many years ago in Europe on the archery range. And the object on the archery range is when letting an arrow go, it was to hit the bullseye. Amen. It was to hit the mark. And being that the bullseye is in the middle, I don't know if the next slide will show us that. Yeah. Show us that picture. Remember this one? There it is. You see the middle of that yellow piece? That's the bullseye. Well, if that arrow lands out there in the red or the blue or the black or out there in the white or out there in that piece of wood that's holding the target up, they measure the distance from the bullseye to where the arrow landed. They measure how far you missed the mark. That was called sin. Sin is missing the mark. Well, that's what we're dealing with, okay? There's a mark that we press towards. There's a standard that we aim to claim. And that mark is to be a Christian. It is to be Christ-like. It is to be like Christ. Right now, for disciples. You know, when you understand that the word Christian is only in the Bible three times, I think. Two or three times. But the word disciple is in there 269 times. And there's a reason for that. When Jesus came on the scene, what did he tell Peter and Andrew and James and John? He said, come and follow me. And he made them disciples. Disciples are followers. They're followers of Christ. Following Christ through the Word. That's what we're doing today. We're following Christ through the Word of God, if you will. Learning. Disciples are learners. We're learning to imitate Him. We're learning to be like Him. He is our example. Now, yes, Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. But they were following the Christ in Paul. If you have somebody following you, you make sure that they're following the Christ in you.
Yes, amen.
Amen? Amen. To be like Christ. Amen. That's our mark. That's what we're pressing towards. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. David said in Psalms 119:11, he said, your word, O Lord, have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Now, he could have said that I might not miss the mark. Your word, O Lord, I have hid in my heart that I might not miss the mark. That's what he was saying. So it is the desire of every Christian, or should be the desire of every true child of God, to depart from sin, to quit missing the mark. That's what we're after. 2 Timothy 2:19 says, the Lord knows them that are His. So let everyone that names themselves with the name of Christ depart from sin. Quit missing the mark. That's our goal. Okay? And don't you know, does anyone in here, have you ever used the bow? Do you hunt with a bow? Do you shoot the bow and the arrow for fun, for recreation, you know? Well, did the first time that you walked out there and let the first arrow fly, did you hit the bullseye? Did you hit the mark the first time? Everybody I talked to, they said that they've never done that. They've never hit the mark the first time out. But you know what? The more they practice, the better they get at it. And it's the same way with practicing. That's what James says in 1:22. Don't be just a hearer of the word, but be a what?
Doer.
Be a doer. It says practice the word. So the more we practice, the more we do the word, we get better at it. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. Because what? Our mind's being renewed. Our mind's meditating on the word of God. Praise God. So we're talking about what we have to do to hit the mark. We want to hit the mark. How many wants to hit the mark? Amen. Praise God. You know, I'm finding anymore that I'll hit the mark every once in a while, Brother Larry. I'm not missing it all the time now, but I am hitting the mark once in a while. Amen. I'm getting better at it. So is it a struggle to stop sinning? You bet it is. It is. We're just going to tell it like it is. All right, Paul did. He said here in Romans 7:15-25, he says, I don't understand the things that I do. For what I want to do and should do, but then on the other hand, that which I shouldn't do and don't want to do, that's the very thing I find myself. There's probably not anybody in here tonight that has trouble like Paul did. But he was honest, wasn't he? And that's the struggle. That's the struggle we're having. Paul's saying here, I'm having a hard time in understanding this struggle that's going on in my mind, causing all this tension and confusion in my life. The struggle. And so Paul explains a little further in Romans 7:21-23. He said, so I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see also another law working in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind, trying to make me a prisoner of the law of sin, which is at work in my members. So, you know, he continues to say here, but I agree at the same time that the law or the principle is good. It is good because it shows to me the areas where I'm still weak. All right, you've heard the old saying, a chain is as strong as its weakest link. So, it's not always a bad thing. You know, God is, you know, when we're God is all about showing us where we're weak. Not to beat us up, not to beat us down, not to condemn us. But he wants to show us the area that we need to be strengthened in. Amen? Praise God. He shows us the areas where we're still weak. Now, this may sound a little confusing, but what I believe Paul is saying here, he's saying that even though I'm born again, even though my spirit has been regenerated, even though my spirit has been made brand new, my old sin nature hangs on me like a stinking dead corpse. That old man. So is this a struggle that everybody battles with? Paul says it is right here in Romans 3:23. He says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. 1 John 1:8-10. This is very powerful. He said, if we claim to be without sin, we are only deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess, our sins. This is powerful. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and he is just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we claim that we have not sinned, we make God out to be a liar, and his word has no place in our lives. You see, I believe what John is saying here, he's saying, beloved, there's two roads here. There's the highway of holiness, and then there's this highway of hypocrisy. He said, if you wanna live in liberty and freedom, confess your sin. Don't be deceived. Confess it. Get rid of the burden. All of you that are weary, weak, and heavy laden, he said, come unto me. Be free. Confess it, and he'll cleanse you. He's faithful and just. But if we take this highway over here, well, nobody's perfect. Everybody makes mistakes. You know, Jesus knows how weak we are. I mean, these are all true, all these sayings. But if we start making excuses, that's what it sounds like, doesn't it? We start making excuses, justifying why we sin. Aren't we just making excuses just to kind of pave the way? We're setting ourselves up to sin again and making it sound like it's okay. And that's the highway to hypocrisy. And the way of the transgressor is hard. It's hard there. We're better off just getting rid of it, just unload it. Amen? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. How easy is it to sin? Well, James 4:17, he says, he that knows to do good, if you know what to do, if you know the next right thing to do, but you don't do it, he said it's sin. It's just that easy. To him that knows to do good, but does it not, to him it is sin. So what's the mark here? It's to do good. Because that's what Jesus did. In Acts 10:38, it tells us how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. And what did he do with it? It says he went about doing good. He went about doing good. Praise God. So it's doing the next right thing. And when we don't do what God has anointed us to do, he has, Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through who has empowered me, who has strengthened me. Amen. So we can do that. But if we don't, it's sin. We've missed the mark again. It's missing the high calling of God in Christ Jesus, because Christ went about doing good, so he wants us to imitate that same thing. All right, so the point is, what are we aiming at? What are we aiming at? There's a target. Are we just going to kind of... Or are we we going to just, are we going to be content? I heard a testimony from a guy that, and he said, you know what, I was just content to be close. Just be close. I think we'll press towards getting close to the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. That's not what the word says. And only you and God knows if you're aiming at that yellow mark in the middle, right? Oh, we can fool people for a while. But Matthew says, by their fruits, you shall know them. So after a while, you start showing. It shows up, doesn't it? How many wants to be the real deal? So we press. Paul uses that word press. I press. I just see a person, you know, just maybe you're trying to work your way through a blizzard, you know, and the wind's blowing, just trying to push you back, and you're pressing. You're trying to press on through the struggle. Hit that mark. I'm aiming at the mark. Getting better at it. Amen. Paul tells us in Romans 14, 19 and 23, he says, and we'll talk about this, just some things here. Let us therefore make every effort. There's a song out right now, and I was trying to remember that this morning. It talks about after this whole thing is over, it talks about, did I do my best? Has anybody heard that? I know it's not much to go on, but maybe I've heard it two or three times on the radio. Mike was here, you know, he can tell me what it was probably. Am I doing my best? Or am I content? Am I content? He says, let us make every effort to do what leads to peace. Do not destroy what God's doing in your life for the sake of food even. And the point he's trying to make here, when he was talking to these people, he said, all food is clean, but it's wrong to eat something that might cause someone else to stumble. You know, I was sharing this morning with the guys over at Salt of Paul. Now, wouldn't it be rude of me? I don't know if anybody in here is vegan. I mean, you're a vegetarian. You know what they're calling vegetarians today? Vegan? That's beyond that. How can you wait? Down the stands or what?
Huh?
Bury me now. I gotta have eggs in my diet. I eat hen fruit. Well, I said, wouldn't it be rude? Wouldn't it be rude if Joel was vegan? And I invited you to my house and I had chicken and roast beef and lamb chops and tenderloins and B's and G's and I had this all spread out, and I'm glad you could come over for supper tonight. I'd be rude, right? So that's just kind of he's telling us, you know, just so you may be free to eat some stuff, but you know, think about your brothers and sisters. Don't be a stumbling block. And on the other hand, he invites me over, and he's having nothing but stems and mushrooms, and I don't know what all's going on. I carry in my own sack lunch from. But he's telling us, for the sake of not being a stumbling block, you know, to cause your brother to fall. You know, so whatever you believe about these things, whatever your personal conviction might be, he's saying, that's between you and God. But blessed is the man who does not condemn himself by what he is approved of, but the man who has doubts is condemned if he eats, because he's eating not from faith in everything that you do. If you can't do it in faith, it's sin. You're missing the mark again. Okay? And you know, I believe God is good. I believe He speaks to our hearts about things like that, about how we can make every effort to be at peace and not, you know, not be as schism to one another. Well, that's just the way I am. If you don't like it, get over it. Well, if that's the way you are, you need to change. Maybe I'm preaching to the choir here this evening. I don't know. Has anybody in here arrived? Have you arrived yet? Do we have anybody in here that's a Mark 16 Christian? Everywhere you go, there's nothing but fire and signs following? Paul says, you know, after having written two-thirds of the New Testament, he said, I have not attained yet. I have not arrived. And after having preached the gospel, I need to be watchful. I need to be alert because I myself could be a castaway. So we're pressing, right? Pressing towards it. So what do we do? Paul asked the same question here. Paul says in Romans 7:24-25, he said, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me? Who shall rescue me or save me from this body of death? Then comes the answer. But thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Once again, we can do all things through Christ. We draw strength from Him. He helps us. Praise God. You know, when we feel bad, when we do something wrong, anybody ever felt bad when you've done something wrong? It's good. That's good. That's a good indication you're saved. Because you have the Holy Spirit in there just, you know.
You know that one, right? You know.
And so He's helping us. You know, He's not condemning us. And I say, Lord, convict me. Convict me when I'm missing the mark.
Amen.
Straighten me up, Lord. Don't let me get by with it. That's a dangerous prayer to pray. You know what I'm saying? But I don't want to get by. Because this flesh will deceive us into thinking, I mean, we can just get out there way too loose, you know. Romans 10:13 says, anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord might be saved. Shall be saved. So does that really mean anyone? Jesus said in John 3:17, for God didn't send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. But that the world through Him might be saved. So how do we deal with sin? Well, I believe one of the aspects, I was thinking about this. I used to have this dog, this 120-pound Rottweiler named Zeppelin. And I had to put an electric fence around the acre down there and around the yard to keep him from running around scaring people because he's a big dog. And Zeppelin did pretty well with it, except when he was really tempted by a raccoon. Now, the possums were crazy. They thought that they could come into his backyard and eat his dog food. And he just loved that. I'd have piles of possums out there. But a raccoon was a challenge for him. They'd skirt real quick across there, and then they'd crawl up the tree in the neighbor's yard and do what they do, and he just couldn't take that. And so he'd charge across that electric fence, knowing full well he's going to get zapped. The consequences, how many know there's consequences when you cross boundaries? Well, he'd cross that, and he'd go over there, and he'd work his business with that raccoon. And I'd look out the window, and he's out there at the same place that he charged over. He's sitting out there. Just, hey, I want back in the yard, knowing he's going to get zapped. And I wouldn't turn the fence off. I thought, you're going to get it twice. And he knew he was going to get it twice. And I'm sure he probably thought about that in a split second and think that it was well worth it. But now, on his way back, he probably didn't think near as much about it. And
I'd go out there and I'd walk him back across that, and he'd yip and yap and squall like a mashed tomcat. Boundaries. The temptation was more than he could stand. He had to learn. He had to learn there was consequences in crossing those boundaries. How many knows there's consequences? The Bible says, depart from sin. Get away from it. Stop it. And don't give up the struggle against it. Proverbs 24:16 says, though a just man may fall seven times, he rises up again. This means he doesn't give up. He doesn't give up. And why don't we give up? Well, 1 John, if we confess our sins, because we believe that, right? If we confess our sins, we know that we can get up again. Thank you, Jesus. So God promises in Psalms 34:19 to uphold and to rescue the righteous. He says a righteous man may have many troubles, but God is able to deliver them out of them all. Amen. You know, yes, we have a born-again spirit, but we're still stuck with the same old brain. Amen. We have the same old mind. But as we renew our minds with the Word of God, this is the answer right here. We will defeat the sin that's in our lives. We're aiming for the mark, so we have to renew our minds. Christ will destroy the works of the devil in our lives if we allow him to. We've got to allow him. 1 John 3:8 says, for this purpose was the Son of God made manifest, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Now, what do you mean he might? Does that mean that he might not be able to do? No, that he might is if we allow him to. We've got to let him. Remember, Romans 12:2 says, don't be conformed to this world. Don't keep on doing the same things that the world is doing. It's those same things that used to get us in trouble all the time. Made us sick and tired of being sick and tired. But be a transformed. Boy, that's a marvelous word, isn't it? We serve a miracle-working God. Transformed by the renewing of your minds. Amen. That you may find that perfect and acceptable will of God for your life. People want to know, what does God want for my life? What's his will for my life? Well, there's no shortcuts. He's saying, renew your mind with the Word, and then you'll understand. Because you won't get it until you do. You won't understand the will of God for your life. Okay, that makes sense? Well, Psalms 107:20 says, God sent his word, healed them. He rescued them from their destruction. Someone said, but Pastor Larry, how come so many Christians seem to have so many problems in their life? Well, number one, we live in a problematic world, John 16:33. I have problems, tribulation in this life. They said someone, you know, they say they believe in God, but they continue to experience the same old problems over and over and over again in their life. Well, it's because you can't live with one foot in the church and one foot in the world. You got to be in it to win it. You got to get out there in the deep. It's hard to swim in 6 inches of water. You got to get right out there in the middle of it. You got to let go of the world. You know, when God romances us, I mean, he's wooing us. He don't want to share us. Right? He's referred to as the bridegroom or the bride. He's romancing us. He's drawing us. He's loving on us. He don't want to share us with the world. We can't satisfy him and the world both. Actually, we're just trying to satisfy us, right? People want to be saved from their distress, but they don't understand that God, he wants to save us from the distress that's coming at us on down the road. Some people can't see any farther than the end of their nose.
They just want the problem to be solved today, what they're going through. But we live in a problematic world. There's going to be all kinds of stuff. So God wants to give us power to overcome all the stress and the distress that's coming our way. Amen. It's because we live in a troubled world doesn't mean we have to be troubled. Praise God. So he wants to change the way that we live. You know, and we have to ask ourselves the question, why do people think that they can still go around trying to live like and act like Jesse James and Bonnie and Clyde and think that they're not going to get caught? Yeah. Nobody gets by, do they? Everybody gets caught. Our prisons are full of people who don't think they'll get caught. Why? Because sin will double cross you. Amen. Sin stinks and it'll smell you out. Right? Our cemeteries are no respecter of persons. They're full of drug overdose victims. They're full of people who thought that sin was their friend. And the reason that God wants us and implores us to get out of the sin business is because sin brings death. Sin brings penalty. Sin brings consequences. Sin brings repercussions. Sin brings destruction and nothing but devastation. Romans 6:23 says, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. I want some of that. Amen. Amen. I believe this makes it pretty plain, don't you? You know, the question I believe is pretty simple. Do you want to live or do you want to die? The world is crying out, stop AIDS, stop world hunger, stop drive-by shooting, stop terrorism. But you know what? The real answer is real simple. It's stop sin and do the next right thing. You know, some people have the belief, and I've heard it so many times, that sin is sin, and there's no sin any worse than any other sin. But the only truth in that statement is that all sin is wrong. All sin is missing the mark. Other than that, this statement is not true and is totally unscriptural. And I believe that it's in this that Christians have a hard time in judging sin or in considering sin. Let me put it this way. If all sin is the same, would you rather have someone to take your money or take your life?
Well, maybe I'll change my mind.
Right? Big difference in there. Especially if you're the one that they're wanting to take something from. Right? That's why we have laws and we have different levels of punishment in our courts today to accommodate the law that's been broken or the sin that's been committed. Jesus says in Luke 12:47-48, he says, and that servant that knew to do the next right thing, knew his Lord's will, and didn't do it, will be beaten with many stripes. But he that didn't know his Lord's will and did commit things that were worthy of stripes shall be beaten with few stripes. For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall much be required. I know there's a lot of emphasis put on how bad smoking is and how that it's wrong. But you know what? I would rather tolerate someone smoking around me than I would someone gossiping about me or talking about me or somebody lying about me or lying to me. Because that's an inner problem. That's a heart problem, isn't it? What I'm saying is that there's different levels of sin. The Bible teaches us in Matthew 12:31, you know what, that we can blaspheme one another. We can even blaspheme Jesus, the Son of God. But if we blaspheme the Holy Spirit, there is no forgiveness. No forgiveness. This is the one unforgivable sin. Even the Ten Commandments, the first four of the Ten Commandments, those commandments, if broken, those first four are sins against God. Then the next six are sins against our fellow man if broken. So there are sins that are committed against God, and there are sins committed against our fellow man. And Paul takes another step where he says in 1 Corinthians 6:18 that there are sins that we commit against our own bodies.
against our own selves. He says here, flee from sexual immorality. He says all other sins that a man commits are outside his body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own body. And so there's consequences. So how we are to judge sin, or how we are to consider sin, should be consistent with the sin and even by whom the sin is committed. I shared this morning, I said, whenever I'm dealing with someone that has been an offense or has really missed the mark, or there's been a stumbling block or whatever, first of all, the person that's sitting in front of me, I want to evaluate, is this person a sheep or are they a goat? Or could they be a wolf? That's a variable that needs to be considered, right? You know? So those are just, you know, once again, Luke 12:47-48, that servant that knows, who knows his master's will, doesn't do what his master wants, you know. Different levels. You see, we will be held accountable for the degree of sin committed, and we will be held accountable to the extent of our knowledge of the sin committed. Someone said, well, now you're only talking about sin that's unrepented of, right? Or unconfessed sin. And of course, we go back to 1 John 1:9. It says, if we confess our sins, he's just and faithful to forgive us of our sins. But how many knows we are forgiven, eternally speaking, but how many knows this world isn't near as forgiving as our God is? Galatians 6:7 says, be not deceived. Don't you be fooled for a second. Sometimes, you know, we Christians go ahead and sin because God's merciful. I'm just saying. You've thought about it. Not thought about sin, did you? You understand what I'm saying? Because God is merciful, isn't he? I've sinned. And he didn't strike me dead. He should have. But he's merciful. This world is not merciful at all. We will pay. You jump off the back of sin's like gravity. You jump off the back of this church, I don't care if you're a Christian or not, you're going to get hurt. Right? Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Like he doesn't know what he's talking about. He said, that which a man sows, that's exactly what he's going to reap. This world calls it what goes around comes around. Amen. Does God sit around? Does he try to think of ways to punish us when we sin? No. He don't have to. He doesn't have to do that. The sin is bad. The wages of sin, the consequences is bad enough. And I believe it breaks his heart. That's why he said, stop! The bridge is out! You know, he's trying to get us to slow down and to get out of the sin business. He don't want us to get whacked. He's a good God. He's for us, not against us. You know, he didn't have to think up anything new because the penalty or the consequence of the sin itself is usually punishment enough. Amen. And besides that, God can't bless sin. Can't bless it. So he wants us out of it. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Well, glory to God. We know that there's terrible consequences to sin. I could go on and on, but we won't do that. The bottom line is, do we shut the door to sin, or do we only just a little bit of an opening? You know, here's how we are sometimes. Sin? You in there? We gotta keep the door closed. Yeah, I mean, you know, you can put your hand on, you can feel his hand on that other doorknob on the other side.
Amen.
So do we want to keep the door closed? Do we want to quit missing the mark? Let's not make it any harder than it is. That's what this whole message is about. Let's quit flirting with it. I remember when my son Buddy was like three or four years old. We had a wood stove in our house, in our mobile home, and had a pan of water on the top of it. That dude was cranking in the wintertime. And you know how little boys are around fire. I mean, he's just over there messing with that stove. And I said, Buddy, get away from the stove. Why did I keep telling him that? I didn't want to get burned. God is saying, get away from the stove. Back up. You know, he's telling us that all the time because he's for us and not against us. And I would tell him, get away from the stove, buddy. Get away from the stove, buddy. Get away from the stove, buddy. Just every day. Finally, one day, there he is over messing with the stove. I walk away. He touched the stove. And you know something about that? He never touched that stove again. He didn't get around it. Now, we need to learn a lesson from that. Now, he was a little fella. He was only 3 or 4 years old. And it only took him one time. We as adults, we keep thinking we can go around that stove again. Right? God's good. Amen. I'm just, you know, God just puts up with us because he loves us so much and he is a good God. But we're overcoming, right? Amen. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Don't give up the struggle against it. The word in you, the word in me will cause us to be overcomers. We can overcome that. We can overcome sin. We can get better. We'll hit the mark. We'll start hitting that bullseye, that mark more often. And you'll just be praising God, knowing that it was Him. Wasn't me. It's all God. Amen? All right. Let's all stand together tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord God, for your mercies, your compassions. They're made new for us every morning. Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for overcoming power in our lives, Father God, to defeat sin, Lord God, to come out on top, Lord God. Lord, you are a good God. We thank you so much, Lord God. Lord, for showing us the way, just being in our lives, Father God, helping us share you with others. Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, that there's victory in the camp, victory in our lives, victory in our church, victory in our families. Lord God, everywhere we put our foot, Lord God, we claim for the kingdom of God. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord. If there's anyone here tonight and you've not asked Jesus Christ to come into your life, into your heart, we want to give you that opportunity tonight. You can know this wonderful Savior. You can know him in his fullness. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. God wants to impart in you power. He wants to impart in you his divine nature. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. This altar is open. We have our prayer warriors to come on up. Help me pray here tonight. Thank you, Jesus. If you have a need, you need prayer.
I hope you enjoyed the service. Once again, if you have not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, just repeat this simple prayer with me right now. Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner in need of a Savior. I believe you died on the cross for me, and I ask you to forgive my sins and come into my heart. And I thank you for saving me. If you prayed this simple prayer, you have been forgiven, and your name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. You are a new creature in Christ. Please write to me and let me know. I'd love to hear from you. God bless you.